Powered by NVIDIA Quattro.
Classic car or muscle car? We want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Coming up on Autorestomod, Jeff and Vinne talk Serpentine versus V-belts on classics, then the lads show how to measure for a custom drive shaft.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
That 5-speed shifter, that was a real pain in the butt.
Well, don't stick it there then.
Not like
that. Oh!
I meant it was difficult with the 5-speed shifter in there to get the console piece in, because you have to have the shifter already there, and the console's this big, long piece, and you got to kind of put it on there and twist. Ugh.
I know, that's why I had you do it.
Yeah, where have you been while I was having all this fun with your car?
I had to go out and test drive the Falcon a little bit.
Oh my God, again with the Falcon? 50th anniversary Mustang show is coming up, not the Falcon show.
You know what's really sad is that NPD wants this car in their booth as well.
I know.
And we even have the other problem too, the fact that we've lost 4 days to bad weather. Now we had a really serious ice storm come through the area last week, and that basically shut us down here at the shop for 4 days, no power. Now, the video I'm putting up right now shows you some of the ice stuff that was going on. Shot this with my mobile phone, so it's not the greatest footage, but it gives you an idea of what the neighborhood looked like as this whole thing was happening. We are now back on track, and this week, what I think we're going to be doing is we're going to be talking about Serpentine belt systems. And the reason we're going into this is a viewer sent in a request for us to talk about how to put a Serpentine belt system in a vintage car, but specifically, not using an aftermarket kit. So that's exactly what we're going to be doing for the first part of this episode. We're going to be going over Serpentine kits, what you can do, what you can't do, and the fact that if you have a Mopar, as far as I can tell, you're just plain out of luck.
Huh. Well, let's get some work done.
Yep.
I'm the 67.
Yeah.
Mustang.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so if you're going to try to get a Serpentine belt system for your classic car, things you want to look out for: measure your tight distances on the width. So in this case, right about between our water bottle and our battery, and we've got right about 29 inches. So you want to take that measurement with you to the salvage yard while you're looking for Serpentine systems. Another thing you want to be concerned about is the distance from your water pump to your radiator. So just kind of, you know, get a rough idea of that measurement also, as well as the height. Go right about from the water pump to whatever the highest component is on the system and get an idea of what that measurement is. Looks like I've got just about a foot above the center of the water pump. So we know that some of the Fox Body Mustangs had Serpentine systems, and for Chevy guys, well, you can go to a third gen Camaro from right about 1988 and newer had the Serpentine systems. You Chrysler guys, well, from what we understand, you're just gonna have to deal with V-belts. Now, where is Jeff? He should be back from getting that Serpentine system by now.
So Vinny's gone over how to measure up the engine bay to make sure when you go to the junkyard you're getting the right Serpentine system. Now the system I have here on the table is our example system. This is actually going to probably be going on our 1964 Falcon when we start working on it. But what I wanted to go over with this is talking about getting all the stuff. And the reason I say that is some manufacturers were really funky about what they did with their installations. Certain bolts that are available on this particular application are only for the Fords of this era. And this is a water pump bolt that is actually a two thread size. In other words, you have a smaller size here and this size here. This goes through here to bolt the bracket to the water pump. Now, if you don't have that particular bolt, you can actually offset your belts and it'll cause a squeak or a problem in your belts and will possibly even throw the belt off the system. So that can be a real issue. So you want to make sure when you're getting all this, you get everything off the front of the block. Like this bracket here is the bracket that actually goes to the back of our compressor. This bracket is very important. Now, when you get everything, make sure you get the fasteners as well, because you're not going to find these fasteners available in the aftermarket on a lot of these setups. And the reason for that is this: Ford no longer stocks most of this stuff, and there are changes, as I've already said, between the different models and all that. So make sure you get the fasteners that are specifically for the Serpentine kit that you're working with. That way you're sure that everything will bolt right up to the block. And when you get it, try to get the whole system off of one car. And the reason I say that is this, is even within the system, like this is from a 5-liter Mustang, there were changes from year to year with Ford Motor Company. And for instance, this setup right here, with this carriage type bolt on the front of it, they quit using that at the end of 1986, 87 somewhere, and went to an actual through bolt that bolted to the bracket. And they actually changed mounting positions and alternator setups as well. There's a lot of little different things that were done to these systems. So if you're getting one for your car, make sure you're getting one A for your particular engine setup, because there is differences on the Ford side of things between 351 and 302. This bracket is available in the aftermarket for a 351 application. Everything else on here is exactly the same. That's what we've got back here in our 1967 Fastback, is that setup for a 351 Windsor. The other thing I wanted to go over is this. If you have a Smog pump, a lot of times on some of these aftermarket setups, you can go in and get something like this. Now, we got this from the Fox side of National Parts Depot for the Fox Mustang parts, and this is basically the Motorsport air pump Elminator bracket. And what this does is it bolts in place right here in order to eliminate the air pump so that you can not have such a long belt run from the alternator down to the main crankshaft pulley. And it'll keep that belt from flopping so bad whenever you're going down the road and running it up into high RPMs, because that is quite a long run for a Serpentine belt. What we have a problem with right now is when we got this kit, we didn't get the bracket that bolts to the block and to the back of that Serpentine pulley. So we've been looking online, and those suckers are running around 30 bucks. This bracket, if you were doing a 351 Windsor, runs in the $150 range. So you start seeing that you're going to be spending some money if you're not careful and don't get everything you need. Now, there are systems out there for pretty much everything. Regular passenger car systems in the Ford line were different than the Fox Body Mustang, which were different again than the Explorer and the pickup truck. Every one of those had something for the Windsors. You just have to make sure that you have enough width and height in your engine bay, as Vinny showed you, to make these work. On the Chevy side of things, the 350 pretty much stayed the same throughout the entire line. But again, always make sure, measure twice and install once, because you don't want to buy a whole system and end up without being able to use it because you don't have hood clearance. Big block side of things, oddly enough, you're fine if you're doing a 385 series Ford, but if you're dealing with a FE motor, you're gonna have some issues, and that is the fact that, quite frankly, Ford never did a kit for the FE motors. Those were basically discontinued before the whole Serpentine craze took over in Detroit. So keep that in your mind when you're doing this. If you're gonna do a Serpentine kit on an FE, you're probably gonna have to go into the aftermarket. Chevrolet big block, you have basically all the way through 2000 in the pickup truck line that you can run a Serpentine system off of those as well. So just keep that in your mind when you're going and looking for these, but make sure of the hood clearance, because on Corvettes, especially in the big block line, you can run into an issue with not being able to clear that low hood on a big block application. Now, I don't want to leave you Mopar guys out. What I found is this. On the Mopar front, I couldn't find any really good substantiating information to say that you should go out and get a kit off of one of these types of cars from this era of engine. And that's really a problem, because I don't want to stand here and say you can do something and not be able to do it, or worse yet, say that you can't do something and you would be able to do it. The only thing I can tell you is this, is you're going to have to do some research in the Mopar market to know if your particular brand of engine is going to have an aftermarket Serpentine kit available. I know that there are some guys that are saying that the LA class of engines can use some of the later model Serpentine kits, but the big blocks, all bets are off. I'm pretty sure you're going to have to go and do something in an aftermarket Serpentine kit in order to make that work. So that's what I've got for you Mopar guys. Sorry, there's just not a whole lot available that I can find at this point to put on your cars. So that's all we've got right now for the Serpentine kits. This is basically how this one sets up for a 351, 302. So now what we're gonna try to do is we're gonna go ahead and move forward on the 67 and get the drive shaft in the car. And Vinny's gonna start working on that right now. All right, Vinny, I got it nudged up against the axle.
Okay, so now we're ready to go ahead and put the drive shaft in the 67. Now, as you can see, we lifted this car up right from the pumpkin, which is okay to do if your differential housing and your axle shafts are all one solid piece. Some of the newer cars, the axle shafts are actually pressed in. Highly recommended you don't lift the car from the pumpkin in that case. Now, over here, we've got a homemade cover that we made. We just used this to plug up the transmission so it wouldn't leak tranny lube all over the place while we're shifting the car around. All right, that slid in pretty nice. And, the shaft is just a little too long. We don't hear that very often. Okay, the problem that I'm having here is that this drive shaft actually has to be able to move a little bit, you know, in and out of the transmission while the car is in motion. Now, I had it all the way bottomed out, and I'm still not able to get this universal joint into the tail shaft on the differential here. So we're going to have this shaft cut down a little bit, and that is not something we're equipped to do ourselves. We're going to have to take it to the guy. Hey, Jeff, grab a tape and come here.
Why? What's wrong?
Your shaft is too long. your drive shaft.
Oh, I was going to say, I've never been accused of that. Here's a tape measure. What's going on? So you say it's...
Yeah, check this out. Let me do this again.
That's a custom drive shaft. It's supposed to be the right length for this transmission.
Custom did it too long. Look how long it is.
Yeah.
There it goes. But yeah, see, now that's all the way down. And we still don't, it's got to come back another half inch yet to be seated correctly.
You're right. That shaft is too long.
Well, that's what I said.
Sometimes that kind of thing can happen. You can run into a case where you've got a situation like we have here. It may be the chassis. It may be the rear axle sitting position. It may be that they're set up for an 8-inch and we have a 9-inch. We're not real sure, but we are going to have to modify the drive shaft. Nobody's fault. Sometimes this stuff happens. If you have to do this and go out to a place and get your drive shaft redone, what you'll want to do is actually have the car jacked up on the rear axles like we have here, rather than having the jack stands on the chassis. That way the axle is sitting in the normal ride position. So what you'll want to do is you want to take a tape measure and run your tape measure to the facing of the back of the transmission on the actual housing itself on the face of that, and measure to the facing of the 9-inch axle or whatever axle you have, the facing of the pinion support here, and we are at 52.5. Now you'll take that measurement to the drive shaft company and they'll be able to get a drive shaft set up for you that is the correct setup for this particular length. Your length will probably be a little different no matter what you do. Even if it's a Mustang, there can be variances in the chassis that'll cause this. Do not go off of the tail shaft, actually go off of the faceplate around there. You can do this cutting by yourself. You can actually go in and set it and weld it and do it all, cut it, the axle shaft down, but I would probably rather take it to a shop, have them do everything and put new weights on it and make sure everything is dynamically balanced so that you've got a good running drive shaft system on the car. Otherwise, you may end up with a drive shaft that's much more wobbly than you would ever want to see. All right.
A wobbly shaft.
Yeah, a wobbly shaft. So it's off to the drive shaft shop. Right. Oh, God. I always sound like Skipper from Gilligan's Island when I get underneath these cars now. Okay, here's what I wanted to show you. We have contacted the drive shaft joint that we use here in our area to basically shorten the shaft for us. And when I told them the measuring procedure that we used, they basically told me that we had to do it a completely different way. So I'm going to show you the way they want you to measure the drive shaft. Now, what I recommend you doing is, if you're going to be doing this kind of thing, contact the drive shaft company that you're going to be using and get their measurement procedure, because that's what you're going to want to use. However they think you need to measure it, that's what you need to measure it out as. Now what they said for us to do was to take the drive shaft, push it all the way up against the tail shaft, and then basically do a measurement from the end of the pinion here on the two mount points for the universal joint bolts, and then draw a center line through here on the universal joint itself, and basically get a measure from this point right here to the center line of your universal joint. Now what I'm going to use is a micrometer like this. Now you can use tape measures, you can use all kind of other stuff, but the mic's going to give you probably the best measurement you're going to get. You can get a mic somewhere like Harbor Freight, places like that. You can pick one up fairly cheap. You don't have to have a really nice Serret like the one I've got here. You can use a cheap one, it'll get you by just fine. All right, to the center of that is right at 3/16 of an inch. So when we go to the drive shaft shop, we tell them that we have a difference of 3/16, and they'll add an inch to that, and we should have a good depth for our drive shaft. So yet again, another way to do this. Now, another thing I'll bring up, when you're doing a drive shaft mounting like this, make sure that the axle that is in the car is the one that you're going to be using. Some axles, like the 9-inch, have different pinion depths from the mounting face to the back of the pinion flange where it mounts into the axle. So you want to make sure that that depth is exactly the same from the pinion to the very back of the axle housing back here. If it's not, it's going to have to be reshortened again. So, or lengthened possibly, depending on what's going on with your. So those things are stuff that you need to look out for when you're putting an axle in a car and putting a shortened or lengthened drive shaft in. Now we got to get this thing back out of here, and I'm quite frankly going to let Vinny do that since I've had to go and remeasure again. Vinny!
Man, I gotta tell you, I'm getting sick of these monkey fighting problems.
And you're one crazy mixed up fella. Oh, I don't know, dude. I mean that's typical of doing something when you modify a car, you know, but I don't know, I'm kind of feeling a little come see, come saw about the Serpentine stuff.
Why? What are you contemplating now?
Well, you know, I put the Serpentine system together for this engine for another car.
Right, right.
Back years ago, and I put it in there thinking, you know, horsepower gains and all that.
Yeah, so you probably got, what, 5, 10 horsepower?
Yeah, I get nothing out of it.
So that's all myth.
It is, yeah, there's really no horsepower gains. The only time you get a horsepower gain off of something like this is if you use the pulleys that reduce the size, and that gives you about 5 to 10 horsepower, but it also causes your alternator to not charge as well, so you end up with a charging issue but a little more horsepower. So I don't know, and there's other little things about it. I mean, honestly, when I did the research on it this time, I found out that it was basically a maintenance thing.
Oh yeah, because you know we're going to be just going through belts as often as we're driving in this car.
That's what I'm saying. That. It's kind of like the gas tank. I mean I'm glad I did it. Glad I did the gas tank because it shows guys how to do it, and we know that. And I'm glad we did this and talked about the Serpentine belt stuff today. But in all honesty, A, trying to find some of these systems complete in the salvage yard, because when we went to the salvage yard to look for this stuff, you know, most of them, people were taking
hard to come by.
Yeah, parts were gone off of them, so you weren't getting a complete Serpentine system anyway. Honestly, if I were doing a classic car, I'd probably stay with a V-belt system.
Yeah, and especially now that you're saying this is all for aesthetics, basically.
It just looks really cool, and it's, you know, from our standpoint, it's you know, it's kind of neat, but...
I think it looks the same as the V-belt system to me. You know, watch this. See? You can't tell, V-belt Serpentine system. Let's get the shaft of the shop.
Yeah, I feel like I've already gotten the shaft. All right, folks, come back and watch us next week on Autorestomod!